It is a great pleasure for me to introduce someone who's become a friend. I'm looking around for him. Where is he? There he is. Russel G. Jones is an actor, and that's really how we got to know him. Because one of our members, Carol Van Dusen, is familiar with him and is a casting director, has known him. And also, Patrick Roman has used him in some of the ethics in the theater program, and to a great delight. And so I'm not going to say too much more about him, because he's going to be telling us all about himself, and it's better to hear it from him than to hear it from me. So here's my friend, Russel.
Thank you, guys. I'm so glad I got here a little bit early so I could see some of the community at work here. It's my first time being here for a platform, and it's rather exciting. I'll just take a second to set this up. And pull this out. So first, I guess I need to thank Anne for inviting me to share some of the blind spot experience with you here at NYSEC. Do you guys call yourself NYSEC, or am I just doing that? I only recently discovered you a few months ago when Carol and Richard invited me to moderate a post-show discussion for the Ethics in Theater series. But I had a wonderful time. It was in this room, so it feels familiar. And so I thank them both for inviting me as well. I've lived here in New York City for more than 20 years, longer than I've lived anywhere else in the world. And one of the things I love about this city is that it's, in many ways, the most concrete example of a high-functioning multicultural society. But as we can all attest, we can still do better. I grew up in Shaker Heights, Ohio, which is a suburb of Cleveland, Ohio. And a lot of times when I say that I'm from Shaker Heights, many times people will recognize the name. Shaker Heights is known for being a couple of things. First, it's known for being founded by the Quaker-like Shakers, who were a utopian religious sect, and they founded the city in 1822. And it's also known for being an affluent suburb. It's known for being a Jewish enclave, and it's known for being one of the first voluntarily desegregated school systems in that part of the country. Thus we begin with these images. Okay. It says, in fact, the residents of Shaker Heights became national news in the 1950s when they decided to aggressively focus on inclusion and integration by rejecting the discriminatory real estate practices of homeowner contracts. And those dictated that you could only sell your house to another white person. So instead of doing that, they acknowledged and addressed white flight, and they approached it head on. They sought out home buyers, who would, by contract, welcome black neighbors. And they consciously and actively worked to eradicate the barriers to a high-functioning multicultural society. So growing up in a society, in a community like Shaker Heights convinced me that racism was an ugly period of history that I had somehow just missed. Yes. And it wasn't until I went to college at Boston University that I began to realize how wrong I was. Boston, which had a very different history of desegregation. Here was a city that waited as long as it could until 1974, I mean just a few years ago really, until the federal government forced them to integrate the school system. And even then, many of the people in Boston fought it vehemently and in large numbers. This is just one of the pictures from that time. So it soon dawned on me that here was a place where the Italians didn't even like the Irish, and vice versa. The white people didn't even like the new white people. Boston is where I learned that much of the world is places for white faces. And now they're calling that white space. And that the white faces were discouraged from knowing how it affects the lives of the people of color, or even acknowledging that this inequitable system called racism or white supremacy even exists. So Boston introduced me to all three forms of racism: institutional, individual, and structural, and they all work together as systemic racism. And this little factoid is one of the ways that we can see how systemic racism manifests itself. With 100,000 black men in the country, and 4,000 of them are incarcerated. That number is off. I remember in Boston my introduction to individual racism because it started to make me aware of some of the prejudice about black people that I had internalized and made my own. It's my freshman year. I was heading back to my dorm on West Campus, and I was in between my classes and my work-study job at the snack bar, and I hear this grown man yelling. And he's yelling from across six car lanes and two T lanes of Commonwealth Avenue. And he's yelling, "Go home, nigger!" And I was shocked. I immediately looked around to see if I could spot who he was talking about, while discreetly looking at my back pocket to make sure that my wallet was there. And then it dawned on me that he was talking about me, and that I was afraid of the black other. I, for one, think that there are still too many places where it's not too cool to be too dark. Stores, schools, streets, whole states even. In fact, too many of our country's institutions, social systems value, validate, and empower those who are deemed white over those who are deemed non-white. And because it isn't very easy to recognize at first, let's take a look at how anti-racist activist Tim Wise puts it when he talks about dominant culture or white privilege.
Come on, Kirsten, work with me. No. The sad thing is, this is my computer, so I can't even blame anybody.
When did you give your finger on your tongue?
Say again?
When did you put your finger on your tongue?
Here you go. Oh, you
got
me.
When
I speak of white privilege, just louder.
The ability to go through life, I don't have to know what people of color experience in this society, because if I don't know, please tell me what penalty will I pay? Nothing. Because I'm not going to have to know that to get a job. That's not going to be on the test. Am I wrong? Is there any test I'm going to have to take? Professional licensing test. Test to become a professor. Test to get into college. Test to get into grad school, law school, med school. To have any job at all where I'm going to have to demonstrate a knowledge of the things that people of color believe are important because they are there. Personal experience? No, at no point am I going to have to demonstrate that. But if people of color don't know what the dominant group is being, is important knowledge, I think you know what happens, and it's quite a bit different. Because indeed, what the dominant group says is important will have to be known by everyone, and especially by those who are in subordinated positions. They will especially have to prove their competence and what the dominant group thinks is important. So it's the privilege of being oblivious to other people's reality. It's why I'm still, 15 years of traveling this country, 15 Februarys, 15 Black History Months. Black men on the road still go to colleges and have students. Otherwise, capable, intelligent people who got pretty good test scores and got into really selected schools. A lot of schools that I couldn't have gotten into, frankly, based on my test scores, still ask me why we don't have Black History Month, and ask it with a straight face. Only because they have the privilege of being oblivious to the fact that we have several White History Months. We just give them these trippy names like May and June and July. The Because those are the months we study a lot of white folks. In fact, we study a lot of white folks in February. Little secret. I thought really like black folks take over for those 28 short, cold days. He's still mostly white folks.
Tim Wise has a certain way with the words when it comes to talking about whiteness and white privilege. And that's just one of the ways that we, one of the things we mean when we say white privilege or how it manifests itself. It's when we're reinforcing whiteness as superior, which we do oftentimes legally, which is broken down rather expertly in the book White by Law, The Legal Construction of Race by Ian Haney Lopez. It's omnipresent inequity, and it deflates and oppresses people of color while it inflates and affords some advantages to those who are deemed white by supporting an illusion of superiority, which is hard to deny. If somebody was telling me that I'm better than other people, I would probably listen to them. But what it does is it sets up some very unhealthy expectations to always be comfortable, especially around the topic of race. And as a result, both cultural sensitivity and self-awareness, which are two necessary components of a successful multicultural society, become real challenges. So how can we convert the societies like the one in Boston into something more successfully inclusive like Shaker Heights? What is the ethics that dictate that we try? And will we do that even if it means that we lose some of our own privileges? Well, fortunately, we are living in a time where critical race theory and critical whiteness theory are being taught in major colleges and university. Corporations and communities like yours are embracing the need to further explore whiteness and white supremacy. And of course, there are many folks, white and non-white, that are actively opposing white supremacy through art and education and activism. Oh, yeah. For my part, I have been developing Blindspot, which is a campaign committed to making the language and critical thinking skills around privilege, race, and oppression more commonplace. So the idea is, normally when we talk about race and oppression, it's because someone just lost their life, or someone lost their job, or someone can't get an apartment, or something dire has happened. And you know, when the dire things happen, whether you're the person who's experiencing it, or you're the person who's watching another human being go through that trauma, it affects us. It affects us in a way that makes us respond in an emotional way. And when we respond in an emotional way, we're responding with our learned behavior, not with what we consciously believe, but with what our fight or flight tells us should come up next. And that's why we get into situations where someone is in a tight situation and they call someone else a racial slur. And they swear they would never do that under normal circumstances. So the blind spot is like, well, let's create some normal circumstances so we can practice these skills and this vocabulary so that we can sort of reset our brain so that when we do get into that situation, we have some other things to choose other than the punch, right? So one of the ways we engage with people is a dialogue-driven, short video-prompted series. So like the Tim Wise video that we just saw, we come together as a group, we talk about whatever the ideas that we want to explore that day, we watch that video, and then we break into smaller groups so we can actually really hear, listen, and speak to one another, maybe a group of six or seven, no more than eight, with a facilitator, and we talk about some of those ideas and some of those challenges around those ideas. And then we'll come back together and we'll watch another video. Normally we do three. The whole thing is being filmed because, you know, whenever there's a camera involved, all of a sudden the accountability is immediate. Even when you have the little kids up here this morning, any one of them, if you put a camera in front of them, they shift. They become just a little bit more photogenic, right? We all do. And it's a lot of the conversations that I see happening about race, and there are a lot of conversations happening about race and privilege and oppression, a lot of them I see are happening online, which is fabulous. The thing is, when I'm online, I can pretend to be whoever I want to be. I can just smack a picture up of Ronald McDonald and say my name is Ron, and I can say whatever I want behind the veil of my computer screen. The salons take that away. It's a challenge to come out of your comfort zone. So Ann and Carol have empowered me to share a series of 4 blind spot salons with you. They're Sunday, September 20th, Sunday, October 18th, Sunday, November 15th, and we're gonna do one in December as well. It's slated as the 20th, but the date may change. And there should be an insert in your program if you're interested in signing up. There should be a someplace there for you to let us know that you wanna come. This next Sunday, the 20th, is only for members of the societies. As we move into October, November, December, we're gonna open it up and invite other members from the larger community. And the questions that we're gonna ask is, what might it take to make the New York Society a more high-functioning, multiracial community? And obviously, you guys have done some steps in that arena before, because you have a nice mix of faces in here. But as we started, we can do better. And in addition to that main question, we're going to ask 2 overarching themes. We're going to look at our intent versus our impact. And we're going to look at the question of why do we need anti-racism? I believe that to build our critical thinking skills in this arena, we need to dialogue about and engage with race, its value in our world historically and presently, and the choices that we make that invalidate each other's humanity based on complexion. So right now I'm going to do just a simple exercise to encourage a little dialogue that I'm borrowing from Dr. Janet Helms, who is a great inspiration to the blind spot, and you'll hear more about her when you come to the salons. I want you to think about culture just for a moment. And I want you to think about when you were 3 years old, 4, 5, somewhere in there. And I want you to try to remember who your main caregiver. And by main caregiver, I want you to specifically think about when you were crying, who was the person that made you feel better? When something hurt you, who took care of you? And I want you to think about how they did that. Who was that person, and what did they do to soothe you, to calm you down? And if just take a moment to think about if any sounds come up, any smells, anything that can help you really sink into that person. And then I want you to turn either to your right or your left and to tell the person who you're talking to something about that person. So we're gonna just take a couple of minutes to talk amongst ourselves. You can decide if you wanna turn to the left or the right. And you're just gonna talk about that person who took good care of you, what they did, what it sounded like, what it felt like. Raise your hand when you're ready to move forward. Raise your hand when you're ready to move forward. Thank you. I'm seeing maybe 2/3 of us are ready. Good. Great. We've got a sort of animated feeling in the room. I saw a lot of smiles. People were enjoying the storytelling. It looked like people were enjoying listening to the stories. And we talked about some of the behaviors and the practices. Maybe there were songs that were cited or stories or specific gestures that were used. And that's all part of our surface culture, right? That's the kind of stuff that we can see. It's aspects of our culture that we can identify just by, oh yeah, I recognize that from my culture. So now, I want you to think again about culture. And I want you to think about the first time that you realized what race society thought you were. The first time you realized what race society thought that you were. And again, I want you to think about who was there in that story, what feelings came up, were there specific sounds, smells, even tastes involved in that story? Just take a second, or 30 seconds, to try to zero in on the first time you realized what race society thought you were. And again, I want you to turn to your same new best friend. But this time, only one person can share their story. So you need to decide who's going to share their story. Only one person can share their story at this point, okay? So we're going to begin in 5, 4, 3, 2, begin. Part of what we do is an electroshock thing. She's like, I'll take it. So the stories about our racial identity sit in a different place. They're not in our surface culture. They're in the deeper culture. And as you can see from this cultural iceberg, maybe you can see it looks clearer on my computer, that the deep culture story is not as easy to spot. And it's basically connected to our core values and how we interpret our core values. And so what we saw as either good or bad or desirable or unacceptable. And as you can see, there's these different institutions of influence, our family, the economic system, the religious system, the history that we live under, the media, that all feed into what our core values are and how we interpret them. And that deep culture is where systemic racism or systemic white supremacy replicates and reinforces itself. And that's where we have to do our work, because it manifests in the way that we see the world. It manifests in how we understand the world and in our actions in it. So just out of curiosity, how many people's stories involved a positive experience? Your story about when you discovered what race the society thought you were. I see 4 hands. I see maybe 6 hands. That's notable. And I want to acknowledge that since only one person got to share, and we all have a story, there may be a feeling of imbalance in the room. And the onus is on us to acknowledge that imbalance and to do something about it. Because this white supremacy social disease has shaped everyone in this room in some way. That is the enemy to our peace of mind. And we've internalized it. And we have to be diligent if we're going to root it out, because it looks just like us and it looks just like the people we love. So being able to identify white supremacy as it manifests in our deep culture is what Blind Spot aims to do. So I'm really happy to be engaging with a group of people who are consciously embracing ethical thoughts and actions in their lives as well, because this is right up your alley. And I am speaking with you today not only because of your rich history of abolition and human rights activism, but also because I believe we are the people that can make this current system do better. This current system is referred to as a caste system. If you ask Michelle Alexander, who is the author of The New Jim Crow, and she says, no task is more urgent for racial justice today than ensuring that America's current racial caste system is its last. And I believe that we can make that happen if we practice recognizing and resisting our own internalized oppressive thoughts and feelings and attitudes, which is a tall order, it is. But I believe that we can do it. I believe that we can do it because we can do better than having a society that chooses one aspect of our identity and we have no control over that aspect to dictate how the world will value us and how we will value one another. We can do better than that. We can do better than having our complexion dictate whether those people whose salaries we pay with our tax dollars deem us human beings or deem us something to be shot and demoralized and or murdered. But first we have to understand that white supremacy is the backbone of the American socialization. It does not serve us to pretend that the civil rights movement eradicated it. There is no such thing as a post-racial America, not today. White supremacy is alive and well, and we have the power to perpetuate it, but we also have the power to stamp it out, if only in our immediate spheres of influence. So by acknowledging and engaging with opposing white supremacy, we can create some more agency for ourselves. We can have choices around race and privilege and oppression. Like the residents of Shaker Heights in the 1950s, we can aggressively focus on inclusion and integration by rejecting this discriminatory system of white supremacy and recognizing that we are part of that system. And I'm gonna leave you after this short clip from social activist and feminist and author Bell Hooks, as she talks about critical thinking as transformation.
Louder, please.
Okie doke. Let me press play first.
Can find ways to transform their lives that can be deeply and profoundly meaningful in the same way that someone who may be incredibly privileged materially and despite this in their life, they may remain perpetually unable to resolve their life in any meaningful way if they don't think critically. As someone who's moved from teaching at very fancy, private, predominantly white schools to teaching at an urban, predominantly non-white campus in Harlem, and the first thing I noticed was that my students were equally brilliant in the Harlem setting as they were when I taught at Yale or Oakland, but their senses of what the meaning of that brilliance was and what they could do with it, their sense of agency was profoundly different. You know, when students came to Yale, they came there knowing that they're the best and the brightest, and they think that they have a certain kind of future ahead for them, and they in a sense are open to embracing that future. It has nothing to do with the level of knowledge. You know, it has more to do with their sense of entitlement about having a future. And what I see among my really brilliant students up in Harlem, many of whom have very difficult lives, they work, they have children, is that they don't have that sense of entitlement. They don't have that imagination into a future of agency. And as such, I think many professors do not try to give them the gift of critical thinking in a certain kind of patronizing way. Education just says all these people need is tools for survival, basic survival tools like their degree so they can get a job. And not in fact that we enhance their lives in the same way we've enhanced our lives by engaging in a certain kind of critical process.
Critical thinking, and I think the fact that you guys are here at the Ethical Society proves to me that you are aware of the power of critical thinking and have already made a commitment to it. So I thank you for being here today. Thank you for having me. The question is, what might it take to make this society a more high-functioning, multicultural one? We have 4 salons. I hope that you sign up and come to one, if not all of them. And thank you so much.